The subject of Mamzerut, meaning illegitimate children, it's one of the painful subjects that tore family apart, community apart. One of a well-known story is the late Rav Goren. Rav Shlomo Goren, I remember him in my childhood. He was the chief rabbi of Israel. Before that, he was the chief rabbi of the IDF. And it was a huge scandal that tore the Israeli apart over question of legitimacy of children that came outside of Israel. And he allowed it, and it was a, it went so bad that his son told me that he used to go to school with bodyguards because it was a huge demonstration over that. So the subject of Hatarat Mamzerim allowed people who illegitimate, meaning, for example, a man have a intercourse with married woman. The child is illegitimate. Now, the child stand before us. What are you going to do? If you allow this child to have children, you increase more Mamzerut, more illegitimate children. You leave him alone, what do you do? Now, post-World War II, there are several well-known responses over that. For example, there is a book called Chelkat Yaakov, the Dayan Weiss, the Minchat Yitzchak, try to pave the way toward our Mishnah, because the Mishnah brings some solutions if a person married a servant, a slave, maid, which basically it's a big question if it still existed in nowadays. The Minchat Chinuch, it's a well-known book, ask a basic question. The obligation of Priya Urviya, the obligation to be fruitful and multiply, that it's one of the commandments in the Torah, is that apply to Mamzer? Because, as we said, he's basically in some potential increase Mamzeriyot. Another subject based on that, we're going to speak about adoption of children. As you know, unfortunately, not everyone has the opportunity to have their biological children. And the question is, what is the right thing to do? Is that better to adopt a baby? And if yes, is that better to adopt a non-Jewish baby? How you treated the child when he grew up in relationship between mother and a child? And more. So, generally speaking, one of the luminary teacher in this matter was Ezra. Ezra was the scribe, and between the first and the second temple, he convinced the community in Babylon to ascend, to have Aliyah to Eretz Israel. And he, with the leadership of Nehemiah, you see it at the very end of the canon of the 24 books of the Tanakh, of the Bible, that he basically tried to select or to be to go to the exactness of offspring, meaning he tried to separate and to make sure that those people who return to Israel from Babylon and build the second Beit HaMikdash are really part of the Jewish faith. Soon you see how he did it, what he did it, what's the consequences. Okay, so we are on page 69, Tractate Kiddushin, five lines from the top of the page of the Mishnah. Rabbi Tarfon Omer, Yecholim Mamzerim Leitaher. Rabbi Tarfon hold, there is some panacea, there is a solution for all the descendants, meaning a person that he is Mamzer, and he married a daughter of Israel, so the baby goes after the father and is also Mamzer. So how you solve it? So according to Rabbi Tarfon, he said, Mamzer shenasa shifcha avlad eved. The way that you purified him, if he married a maid servant and she have a baby together with him, so the offspring go by the mother, and therefore is no longer mamzerut. It's the mamzerut applied to Israel and not in the manner of slaves. Shichrero, if he release him, release the child. Nimtza haben ben chorin. So the child is now a regular Israel. Rabbi Eliezer, disputed with Rabbi Tarfon. And he said, Harei ze eved mamzer. It's the same. So it's a disputation between the Minchat Moshe and versus the Avnei Miluim. The whole concept of Tfisat Kiddushin Be'eved, how do you have a matter of betrothed when it's come to a servant? But here, the Gemara starts with Rabbi Tarfon. Ibayalu Rabbi Tarfon lechatchila o diavad kamar. You mean to say that the Rabbi Tarfon speak as a mamzer is permitted to marry a maid servant the way that it should be done in the first place, or it's only in a hindsight, in a after the fact? But if it happened, it's permitted. So Tashma amru lo Rabbi Tarfon, sages said to Rabbi Tarfon, tiart et hazcharim velo tiart et hanekevot. You purified the male offspring of mamzer, but not the female. Why? Because the reality is, women usually don't tell you the whole background. In a sense, it's embarrassment. So they try to in a hidden way to get married, right? V'yamar lechatchila ka'amar, mamzeret namei tinsiv le'avda. If you tell me that that should be, that mamzer permitted to marry, so it's a female mamzeret, she can marry lechatchila to a slave in order to purify her descendants, and therefore you don't need anything. So why you differentiate between man and woman? So he said, Eved en lo chayis. A slave has no lineage. Even if she were to marry a slave, the child would not be considered his, but will be a Jewish mamzer like her. So as a result, you have no proof what the Gemara asked. So they said, Tashma. It's a story with one of the Amoraim. The Ush Piz Pezi Chnei, the Rabbi Simlai, that Rabbi Simlai host a mamzer. Mamzera, v'amar le'i akadamtich, taranitru livnach. Which means, if I knew you before you married that woman, I give you a guidance, an advice, how to purify your child. That's what we said earlier, what the Chelkat Yaakov said, etc. So there is a book called Aruch Laner. He asks a general question. Soon you see example. Can you take a from a dead body? Do you allow to take without permission a limb? Even for the Pikuach Nefesh, he holds that it's gneiva, that it's stealing. The Nodab Yudai allow it in the press circumstance. But soon you see the connection. When it's come to this, ve'i amar bishlama lechatchila shapir, if you tell me that Rabbi Tarfon allow even lechatchila to marry a maid servant, ela yamar diavad mainiu. So he said the mitzvah eitz, amar lezil gnoviz daban be'even ivri, the same manner. He told him, you know what you do? You steal, but you still in intent to do what? To sell you as a Hebrew servant. So the moment they sell you, so you even lechatchila allowed to marry a Canaanite maid servant, and that the way you purified. So he advised him to steal, not in order to get anything, but to be sold as a slave. So Rashi have a challenge, the how you do that, only if the Bedin recognized it. Is a famous response from the rabbi of Strasbourg. He asked, it was a game on Purim in that time, that people get drunk and they steal from each other. And he asked a question, if letzorech simcha, if for the simcha of Purim it's permitted or not. Anyway, ubdishnei rabbi, the rabbi Simlai, eved ivri miyava, it was a Hebrew maidservant at the time of Rabbi Simlai, v'amar mar, en eved ivri noheg, the whole manner of which we have a Hebrew servant, applies only ala bizman shayo vel noheg, only in the years that they have the Jubilee year in practice. So Rabbi Simlai lived many years after the observance of the Jubilee year ceased. Elalav shma mina, Rabbi Tarfon lechatchila kama. Shma mina. So he advised him the way it should be lechatchila, and the halacha, Rabbi Yehuda Mar Shmuel, הלכה כרבי טרפון. So the Shulchan Aruch in Eben Ezer, chapter 4, he elaborates how you go by that advice of Rabbi Tarfon, which in a way, that's what we said earlier, the Chelkat Yaakov advice to reconcile the issue of Mamzerut. But anyway, Rabbi Eliezer Omer, הרי זה עבד ממזר. Rabbi Eliezer disagrees and he says, no, it's a slave that is Mamzer. אמר רבי אליעזר, מה התחמד רבי אליעזר? דו, מה קרא, הלך אחר פסולו, the Torah said, לא, meaning even the Mamzer in the 10th generation, the volume 23, לא יבוא, should not enter the congregation. So what does that mean, לא? You have to go by whom? Follow his parents with the flow lineage. And the child is a Mamzer. So it's a question, some rabbis ask a question, what's the concept of Mikveh Tahara, when someone goes to a ritual bath? So they have Taf Taf Kuf, lugim. So basically, each time you duck, you reduce. So they ask a question, if that's the case, why in the 10th generation he still hold Mamzerut? And basically the rabbi said that that's the beauty of Dor Asiri, that the Torah tells us that even the 10th generation, that it's appear on the surface, that the 10th generation already eliminate the issue of Mamzerut, it's still there. Which go a little bit, we are now, I think with the Lag BaOmer, the whole Kabbalistic concept. You remember the other day we talked about the Song Bar Yochai, Kav Yarok, all the concepts. So one of the Kabbalistic concepts is the idea that the semen, the sperm, the spiritual part, it's a descendants. It's not disappear because it's come from the wrong source. And that's the problem from the Kabbalistic views. But anyway, the Rabbanan.
Biological view as well. I mean, it's genetic. I mean, it doesn't go away after 10 generations. It's still a genetic descendant. I mean.
So the Rabbanan, so the sages that dispute, which means Rabbi Tarfon, that dispute Rabbi Eliezer. So how we derive from the word law? Ahu b'Yisrael shenasa mamzeret, sakra atach lemishpechotam levet avotam ktiv. So if a fellow Jew marry mamzeret, atalo apkei. So you have the word law, and of his, in the previous side, verses come to exclude him from his father's lineage, as it indicates that his lineage follows his mother when she is a mamzeret. So Rabbi Eliezer, how he derived? La af al gav dechatav lemishpechotam lebeit avotam, ata lo apkei, hachana me'af al gav dechtiv ha'isha v'yiladeh tiyeh lanu mea, ata lo apkei, v'rabanan. So they said, kol valad shebemei shifcha knanit kivlad bimei be'madami. So they said, any offspring that is in the womb of a knanite maidservant, is considered like an offspring of an animal's womb. What does that mean? It means that you treat it accordingly. That it is impossible for the fetus to be tainted by his biological father's blemish. Hadran alach haomer. The Chabin Rav, the Rav of Chabin, have a big chidush, a big write-up about a non-Jew that went to the process of the Bet Din, and he was already did the Brit Milah, but he did not duck himself in a mikveh, mal velo taval. So he slept with a regular Bat Yisrael, and they have a baby. So he hold that Beyado Liot Yehudi, have the potential to duck himself in a mikveh, and therefore in a hindsight, he's considering a fellow Jew, and therefore the son of the Yichus, the same, the lineage, the same as the father. And basically he elaborated in his response to the Chabin Rav. But anyway, the Perek Revi, the fourth chapter in Mitzvah Shem, we're going to deal first. It's Gemara instructed Sanhedrin, speaks about Ezra. The Gemara said over there that Ra'ui Ezra, that Ezra is befitting that the Torah should be delivered by him. Because he tried to purify, to bring the thing the right way. So the Torah tells us, as we said earlier, in the book of Dvarim, chapter 23, that there are certain people are prohibited to enter the congregation of Israel. Mamzer, Amoni, Moavi, we're going close to the book of Ruth, Edomi, Mitzri, and Canaanite slaves. Certain prohibition apply to Kohanim, divorcee, Chalutza, regular Kohen, Almana, the widow, to a high priest. So here we continue with the issue of the lineage and the offspring. As we said, a baby that was born from someone that it's issue of legitimacy, cannot marry everyone. He is limited, he or she, soon you see, in certain cases, limited to certain people they can get married. So here, the first Mishnah dealing with 10 different category of the lineage that you can go. And first, they deal with the era of Ezra, those Jews that came from Babylon to build the second temple. So Ezra basically divided, he separated those problematic people, and he left in Babylon only those who have the proper lineage. So the reason he did it is because he figured out that those erudite sages are not there to check them. So, and he figured out when he gets to the Yerushalayim, he gets the Supreme Rabbinic Court, they separate them that they should not mix with everyone else. And Asara Yochasin Alumi Bavel. So, categories of lineage, certain restrictions on marriage, went with those Jews that ascend from Babylon to Eretz Israel. Kohanei, Leviyei, Veisraelei, Chalalei. So as we said, these three categories, Kohen, Levi, Israel, Chalalim, the one that, in the cohabitation between Kohen and women that he is prohibited, such as widow to Kohen Gadol and divorcee or Chalutza to a regular Kohen. Geirei, convert, Vacharurei, Knanite slave that release, Mamzerei, Netinei, Shtukei, Vaasufi. Kohen, Levi, Israel, Mutorim, Levo, Bezze, Bezze, obviously. לביאי ישראלי חללי גרי וחרורי מתונים לבוא בזה בזה. גרי וחרורי ממזר ומתינה שטוקי שטוקי. Soon you see that the child asked the mother, who is my father? And she had no clue. So she is like quiet. She doesn't know the answer. ועשופי, someone, unfortunately, you talk to people in the third world, you find a child, a baby in the garbage crying. Right? So you collect it from the street. כולם מותרים לבוא זה בזה. So they can marry each other. So, for example, Mamzer or Natin can marry with Shtuki and Asufi. Velo and Shtuki. So here is an example. So the Shtuki, Kol Shu Makir Et Imo Venu Makir Et Aviv. His mother have an affair and is unknown with whom she have relation. So when he calls somebody daddy, she quiet down him. She says, no, don't say it. Right? That's what Rashi said. Asufi, what is the Asufi? Someone called Shenayasaf Minashuk, someone who's founding in anyone who's collected from the marketplace. So, Veno Makir lo et aviv lo et imo. He unfortunately doesn't know the identity of neither his father nor his mother. Abba Shaul haya kore leshtuki bdukei. Abba Shaul used to call Shtuki a label or Bduki. Bduki meaning that you can check him. And meaning there is a way to check this type of Shtuki. And later the Gemara elaborates of how we can investigate it. The Gemara in 74a will explain the significance of Abba Shaul's terminology. Now, the Gemara speaks about the first statement. Asara yuchasin alumi bavel. We said that 10 categories of lineage ascend from Babylon. Ma'ir ya alumi bavel. Why you say ascend? Said nidne alchu le'eretz Yisrael. So the Tosfot Rosh and the Maharsha said, you know, the Eretz Yisrael, it's higher. But there are people who come from other places that is not lowest Babylon. So you should say, Halchu. So, Milta da Gav, Ochi Kamash Melan, Kiletanya. You learn, by the way, another thing. Vakamta Balita la Makomu Shevchar Hashem Lakuecha, the Torah commanded us in Devarim 17, you should ascend to the place that God chooses. Melamed Shebet Emgidash Gavoa Mikol Eretz Yisrael. Meaning that the holy temple is higher than all of Eretz Yisrael. And then it's also teach us, ואירץ ישראל גבוה מכל הארצות, and the ארץ ישראל is higher than all the other lands. So the Chatam Sofer, you see it also in the Makne, the Chatam Sofer asks a question. You go now, getting to Lag Baomer, right? Bar Yochai, living in, dwelling, buried in Har Meiron. If you measure, Har Meiron is higher than the Har Abayit, the Temple Mountain. So he explained beautifully that the world is like round, like a ball. So therefore, if you treated the world, the universe, like a ball, so it's not such a thing highest. You just go for Makom Yetzirah, the place that you build the world, the key point, the source, the roots that you build the world. And since the roots of all the world, it's called Yenikata Koach, the way that you planted the seed that dispersed the whole world, is coming from the Beit HaMikdash and from Eretz Yisrael. So therefore, you have Yenikata Kedusha, you have the source of spirituality, the source of the dividedness. So therefore, even you have the Shitat HaRaived. The Raived said, nowadays, the sanctity of the Beit HaMikdash is not the same sanctity it used to. The Chatam Sofer still hold that even we have temporarily Churban, temporarily destruction of Beit HaMikdash, it still hold a sanctity, and therefore the idea of heights is the source or a height in the sense of spirituality. But for sure, it's in the Rome Sadeh, and others have much more to say. Bishlama Beit HaMikdash Gavoa Mikol Eretz Yisrael. If you tell me that the Beit HaMikdash, the holy temple, he is higher than all of Eretz Yisrael, so we understand this. By the way, I just want to answer Gilbert, the question you asked earlier. It just came to my mind, I have to say it. There is a response from Rav Sternbuch. Rav Sternbuch was a great rabbi in South Africa, then he went to Israel, he was a Dayan, great rabbi in Hanof. So somebody came from Brazil, and he claimed that he was one of those from the tribes, from all those tribes. So the question is how you treat him. You treat him as a mamzer, you treat him as a pagum, you take him to a process of conversion, you don't, how you treat it. So Rav Sternbuch Mechadesh, and he said, "Apesha asar u'apesha itir," the same mouth that prohibited is the same mouth that allowed. So he said, therefore, since that fellow anyway, by himself, he initiated the idea of conversion, so therefore he is full Jewish, and therefore you don't have any chashash psul, and you don't have the rules that we mentioned day before yesterday of shavya nafshia chaticha de isura, that the enemy means that things question over, since he went to conversion, it's over, sincere conversion. But again, there are so many cases that need to deal with people that claim that they are Jewish by some lineage or by some sources, and then you ask a question, what happened in between those generations with the assimilation and so many other problems, that, you know, people sleep with other people, unfortunately, and it's a lot of complications, and therefore you have to ask each case how you treat it. But anyway, it's a response from Rav Sternbuch. 69b, Divrei rivot bishareha bekamta ve'alita, אלא ארץ ישראל גבוה מכל ארצות מנהלן, דכתיב, ולכן מימים בין בין ומשם, that's Jeremiah, לא יאמרו עוד חי השם, אשר אלה את בני ישראל מארץ מצרים, כי אם חי השם אשר אלה את בני זרע בית ישראל מארץ צלפונם, כל ארצות אשר ידחתים שם. So here you see a source that ארץ ישראל is higher than all the others. רבי צדוק הכהן מלובלין, he said, what does that mean? ובאו העובדים מארץ אשור, those lost came from אשור, Assyrian, והנידחים, and those lost, מארץ מצרים. And then building בית המקדש. So he explained, thank you. He explained the difference between נידח and עובד. He said נידח, the someone who has the principles. He is a communist, or he is an ideologist. And then he find out the truth after a serious investigation. Versus עובד. עובד is בעל תאווה, someone who is just go by his desires. This person is different category. So the first is those who really search to find the truth, and then Bawa of Dim, those people who come from Eretz Ashur. And only then, those people who follow the Yetzirah, the Ta'avot, the desires, then Anidachim Eretz Mitzrayim is a symbol of Ta'avot, is the land of Egypt. Anyway, Ma'ir Adetan Alum Bavel, Itna Alul Eretz Israel, Misal Rabbi Lazar, Namar Rabbi Lazar, Lo Ala Ezra Bavel, Ad Shasak Resoret Nekiyah Ve'ala, that's the beauty of Elazar, Ezra, that Ezra did not go up from Babylonia, until he made it like a beautiful, fine, clean, sifted flour, and only then he ascended to Eretz Yisrael. So, That's the idea, that Ezra clean old Babylon from Psulim. So that's the Asara Seyuchasim, the 10 category of lineage that came from Babel. Itmar. Abba Yamar Elum Elen Tnan. Rabba Amar Elum Tnan. You have to differentiate between if they took them up against the will versus they went and happy to go. And what's the difference? וקמיף ליגי דה דיספידיש מתווין אביי ונרבה ודרבי לזר דאמר רבי לזר לא עלה עזרם בבל על שעשה כסול נהיה ועלה אביי לא יתלד רבי לזר רבי יתלד רבי לזר איבאי תימה דקולה על מהית לאו בורת אביי ורבה הולד רבי לזר דת עזרה מיד בבלון as a fine sifted clean flour in a sense of simile right that it speak about the people ואחר בהקמיף ליגי מר סבר אביי הולד Afrusha Afrashinhu. Abaye said that they just totally separate those who are genealogically unfit. And Rava hold Uminafshayusliku. So those who are unfitting when ascend by themselves in order not to recognize them. Umar Savar Balko Chayasiknu. Rava said no, it wasn't in the initiation that they brought them up against the will. Bishlama leman damar, that's good according to Abaye, alu ayinu damar avyu damar shmuel kol haratzot yisa l'eretz yisrael v'eretz yisrael yisa l'bavel. So it means that the whole mixture is different when it's come to Babel, because all the other nation, it's like mixture. When you make flour, so you combine water and barley and flour, so that's the mixture. Versus Eretz Yisrael, Elamad Amar, Elum, Meida Yadinu, they know. Neidi Yad Elahu Dara, Darachin Elahu Yad, unfortunately, they know for that the status of that generation, but it was not known to other later generation. Bish, Elamad Amar, Alu, Ayinu Dichtiv, when you're talking about ascending, that's what they said in Ezra chapter 8, Va'akabtsem Elan Araba El Ahava. It's the name of river. ואנחנו שם ימים שלושה. We settled there 3 days. והבינה ועם והכהנים ומני לוי ולא מצאתי שם. So it means Ezra didn't know who are those people who ascend. אלא מן דאמר העלום המזר זהירי. But according to one who said that they ascend, they have to check them. ניד איזורו בספולים בקשרים לא יזדהו. They granted that they were attentive to the identities of the unfit persons, but they are not attentive to the identities of the fit persons, which means that Ezra was not aware of the absence of Leviim until he surveyed the people in route. Then the Gemara said the Mishnah, Kohanei Leviim Yisraeli, that these people ascend with Ezra. Melanu Lisliku, how do you know that they went up? So they said, Echtiv, because they said in Ezra chapter 2, וישבו הקונים והלווים מן העם ומשוררים והשוררים והנתינים בעריהם וכל אור ישראל בעריהם. So you see here a sword that specifically כהנים לווים and all the other Israel ascend. For sure there is a lot of right up, the Tosfot Rosh and others, what exactly happened, how. Anyway, חללי גירי וחרוגי, חללי מנענה, that those כהנים that have relation with unfitting and then the child is חלל, how do you know that they ascend with him? נתניה רבי יוסי אומר, גדולה חזקה, שנאמר מבני הכהנים, בני חוויה, בני הקוץ, בני ברזילי, אשר לקח מבנות הברזילי הגלעדי, אישה ויקרא על שמם. אלה ביקשו כתבה, מתייחסים ולא מצאו, ולא נמצאו, והגרו לו מן הכהונה ויאמר את רשעיה, which is נחמיה, להם אשר לא יאכלו מקודש קודשים, עד עמוד כהן לאורים ולתומים, which is until the משיח. So that's the חזקה בית דין. So you cannot change the status of the חזקה by just a new ראיה, ואמר להם, so נחמיה said, הרי אתם בחזקתכם. במה הייתם אוכלים בגולה? What exactly, he not tried to investigate. He said to them, you have retained your presumptive status, which means, despite the failure to provide proof that they were fit כהנים, they maintained that their prior status, so he said, הרי אתם בחזקתכם, במה אתם אוכלים בגולה? בקודשי הגבול, אף כאן בקודשי הגבול. You partook in the exile, you partook only of the consecrated gifts of the boundaries, which is the truma, which may be eaten anywhere. So here you talk about Eretz Yisrael, you may partook only on the consecrated gifts of the boundaries. So anything that must be eaten inside Yerushalayim, so that's different. But what you see that there were halalim who came to Israel in Eretz Yisrael. So the Gemara in Ketubot 24b bring the disputation if you ascend truma liyochatzin, which means if you see someone who is a Chazkat Kohen and he eat truma, so if you can take him as also in regards to lineage. So they said, ולמנדה אמר מלי מתרומה ליוחסין, הנה דאכול בתרומה עתו לעסוקין הוא, ששעניאתם דריח הזכתה היו. The situation was different because the status was widely known to be flawed. So even that they were forbidden to eat sacrificed food, so no one will mistake, then forfeit כהנים. So ואלה, מה היא גדולה חזקה? So what is the idea of the חזקה is great? What's Rabbi Yossi find? So it means that you have a higher koach. So he should say, well, how do you know the chazaka moila is effective? The meikara achul bitruma de rabbanan, because originally they go by the rabbinical truma, since it was only truma that existed in Babylon. Why? Because biblically speaking, by the Torah, the truma applies only in Eretz Yisrael. Well, if sof achul bitruma de oraita. So because the chiyuv, the obligation of tightening is applied only to Eretz Yisrael. That's the Gemara in Yevamot 81. If in our days is the same obligation, not, is the Rambam, the Ravid, etc. The Vilna Gaon. So they said, V'ibay tema, lo olam, the truth is, hashtanami, here in Eretz Yisrael, bid the Rabbanan achul. Bid oraita lo achul. V'chim maskin, mitumal yuchasim, bid oraita, mit Rabbanan lo maskina. So if you go by that way, you go by the only the biblical by the Rabbanan, you do not ascend from Truma to Yochasin. So Gemara said, "Yachem, ma gedola chazaka, the meikar alekal legzor mishum Truma doraita, lefsor aval gabdei kan migzar even the Truma do Rabbanan mishum Truma doraita, bed Rabbanan achul bedoraita lo achul." So the Gemara said, "V'aktiv," he said in the book of Ezra, chapter 2, "V'yomer tirshata," which is Nechemiah lahem, "Hashor lo yochlu mikodesh hakodashim." So it means, specifically mikodesh hakodashim, that they don't do it. "Hu de lo yochal akol midei neichul," but anything else which is offering that's not of the most sacred order, they may eat, including produce that is truma by the Torah law. So he explained, and he said, the truth is, the answer is this, lo mide de mikre kodesh, which is truma, ve lo mide de mikre kodashim, but, and the Gemara elaborate, lo mide de mikre kodesh, not, neither that the which is called holy, meaning truma, dichtiv, וכל זר לא יאכל קודש. It was in Leviticus 22 that someone alien not eat קודש. ולא יאכלו מידה דמקרי קודשים דאמר קרא ובת כהן כתהיה לשזר, היא בתרומת הקודשים לא תאכל. ואמר מר במורם מן הקודשים לא תאכל. So, נחמיה said basically that כהן חלל cannot eat קודש. תרומה דאורייתא. But also the issue, the chol kodashim, that's the matnot kuna. But the whole idea is that he didn't, the second lashon is only allowed the truma drabanan. So it's a book on the Torah called Mishchat Aaron. Mishchat Aaron explains that how you treated Kohen Halal. Kohen Halal is less than Levi. Right? So it's a book called Knesset Yisrael, Knesset Yechezkel. Knesset Yechezkel asks a question about in our days, Chazkat Kuna, how you treated the Kohanim today? So he said you treat them like a real Kohanim, but not everyone agrees. There's a famous story about Rabbi Gaon. Rabbi Gaon about 8th century. So the story goes that he talked to Eliyahu Novi, for sure we don't understand the concept, but that's, so Eliyahu Novi showed him 300 Kohanim. And he said to him around the Har Habayit, and he said to him, you see this, Eliyahu said to Rabbi Gaon, you see these 300 Kohanim? You see the fellow that is limping and try to catch them? He's the only real Kohen out of the 300. That's a famous statement. So therefore, if you go by that way, World War II. It was a question that posted to many, many rabbis. Those women that was captured during the war, can the Kohanim now marry them? or not. So basically, as we said, there are people, there are sources that dispute it, but the Knesset Yechezkel said that all these issues was only applies to the first Beit HaMikdash. Since the second Beit HaMikdash, the Kohanim have Chezkat Kohanim, and obviously we need to wait to the end of the days to know the truth, absolute truth, who is the real Kohen and who is not.